Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us for our webinar titled Brick and Mortar Meets Digital, Digital Experiences with APIs at Target. My name is Wayne Chen, and I'll be your moderator today. With me today is Heather Mickman, Senior Group Manager of the API and Integration Team at Target. Before we get started, just a reminder that all of your lines will be muted throughout the webinar. So if you do have any questions, feel free to enter them directly into the Q&A box in your WebEx interface. And then we'll address all the questions, or as many as possible, at the end of the session. So with that, I will pass the mic over to you, Heather. Take it away.
Great. Thanks, Wayne. So good morning, everybody. I'm Heather Mickman. As Wayne mentioned, I lead the API program and integration practice at Target. I've been with Target for about 8 years, and I've worked in technology for almost 20 years, and I'm psyched to be able to tell my story to you guys today. I will admit I always find webinars a little tough because I'm sitting here in this room all by myself talking into a speakerphone, and so it's hard for me to tell if my story is resonating with all of you guys, so hopefully it does. And if you hear me laugh at my own awesome jokes, it's because I'm kind of cueing you in that was a joke, even though I'm terrible at telling them. So what I'm going to talk about today, as Wayne mentioned, is the work that we've done over the past few years to build and scale an enterprise API platform and APIs to enable creating digital experiences for Target. What I'm not going to do is spend a ton of time on the technical implementation details, but I will talk about the context of the need for our APIs, some of the business drivers, how we approach the solution, keys to the success for the team to make this happen, and then kind of what we're looking at and thinking about in 2015. We actually have a really big year ahead of us from an API and integration perspective. So what I've done today for kind of a story and content to walk through, so I've mashed together from a couple of talks I did last year, and also a great talk that Dan Kunduf, who's the principal engineer on my team, that he gave at the Cassandra Summit last year. So kind of pulled a couple of different stories together to walk you guys through today. So as Wayne mentioned, there should be plenty of time at the end for questions. So please post them as I'm talking, and then we can have an interactive session at the end of the call. All right, so before I start getting into some of the details, I do just want to give everyone an overview of Target and our technology ecosystem, and then I'll get into those details. So my guess is most folks are probably familiar with Target. We opened our first store in 1962, and there's now more than 1,800 stores with headquarters locations around the world. We're based in Minneapolis, Minnesota. We also have headquarter offices ranging from Bangalore, London, even Cairo. We also have more than 40 distribution centers and are the second largest importer in the U.S. I remember the first time that I heard that stat, and I was kind of surprised, but I think I like calling it out because it really speaks to the volume and scale that we operate at within Target. Target, of course, so over the years, we've added new businesses to core retail, and that's included banking, pharmacy, and healthcare. Also, I want to call out that at Target, we call our customers our guests. So you will hear me refer to guests probably many times today, and that's because at Target, we're very committed to providing an exceptional experience to each and every guest. And we really focus on fulfilling the needs and fueling the potential of our guests. So Target's growth in stores and businesses over the last 50 years has led to a really large technology footprint. I'm sure most of you have seen Target's in-store technologies, like our cash registers or price checkers, those handheld devices that you'll see our team members using to restock shelves. We just rolled out new gift registry iPads across our entire chain. We have guest Wi-Fi within the store that make it really easy to use the awesome Cartwheel app on your mobile phone. And interestingly, I learned in talking with some folks in our store operations team that because technology enables so much of what goes on within a store, that if there ever is any kind of technology outage, it actually is more efficient for the team members to wait for that issue to be resolved versus starting to manually restock shelves or place the replenishment orders. So even with that much technology that you'll see within our stores, there's even more technology behind the scenes from the applications that make sure those 40 distribution centers are getting the right inventory to the right stores at the right time. Of course, like servers in our data centers, Target.com, we have a number of guest-facing mobile apps, the phone systems in our guest contact center. I mean, I could go on and on, right? It takes a lot of technology to run a modern retailing company. So you might imagine as well, so as Target's grown over the last 50 years and that technology footprint has expanded, that means we have growing complexity within our environment, right? So the footprint's expanding, the number of applications that we have has continued to increase, the number of technologies and tools have grown, our infrastructure, of course, has expanded, and kind of along with all of that, our technical debt has increased and increased over the years. To keep up with that complexity, what we did as an IT organization is we added process and organizational structure. And we have silos within our IT organization. I'm sure most folks on the call do as well. And we optimize our silos, right? Because, of course, we want to be efficient with how we're doing technology work and how we're operating within our IT environment. But that's organizational complexity to work through as we are doing our work. So we have that technical complexity we have and the debt. We have this organizational complexity. And over the last 50 years, since Target first opened that store, everything has changed, right? I can't think of maybe one thing that's the same as it was 50 years ago. But so how we communicate, how we dress, how we listen to music, how we watch TV, right? And, of course, how we shop. We have all changed how we shop in the last 50 years. In fact, so I'm a mom with two kids, and I think about myself and how differently I shop now than I did even 6 months ago. And that's because my expectations continue to evolve. I'm sure yours do as well. And that's because Target guests, well, we've changed how, where, and when we want to shop. So technology is in the hands of basically everyone. If we were in a room right now, I'd say, like, raise your hands if you don't have a smartphone, right? My guess is probably nobody would raise their hand. So it's not enough for us to be a big box retailer anymore. It's about connecting with our guests anywhere, anytime, anyhow. And that's because the retail market has been disrupted, right? And it continues to be disrupted more and more frequently as the pace of innovation and changing technology continues to explode. So Target needs technology, of course, to remain a leader in retail. We need that technology to be flexible, scalable, and have the ability to quickly test and learn new strategies with our guests, stores, or even our supply chain. So this marketplace disruption, that technical and organizational complexity that I mentioned, that was the backdrop for a key technology strategy in 2012 with APIs. We knew we needed to start creating APIs to expose core assets so that Target could create cool digital experiences quickly and to start simplifying our internal architecture. So important to call out is that that technical complexity I mentioned earlier, a lot of our legacy work had grown by point-to-point, really batchy integrations, and that led to a very tightly coupled architecture. You can imagine with that tightly coupled architecture, making even small application changes was really, really complicated. So quarterly release cycles were pretty normal for us. I don't know about you, but for me, I don't like quarterly release cycles. It means a lot of risk because I'm pushing a lot of change at one time. And so you know there's always going to be problems when you push that much change at one time. In fact, we've probably all lived through many of those different types of releases, and I can say I do everything in my power to never have to go through those types of releases again. And so what we did to start kind of addressing and moving forward with a more simple architecture was to build out a platform and APIs. And so we focused initially on APIs that you would probably expect would be important for a retail company, and that would be around like products, store locations, prices, promotions. And we've done that. We've built and exposed APIs from many different back-end providing systems across a variety of different platforms. So now we're in a position to quickly test and learn with different guest experiences, whether we're building that internally. And so on the slide that's showing now, the two screenshots at the top on the left is just a few images from our mobile app, most of which is enabled via the APIs. And then on the right-hand side shows the store locator. And again, that's being enabled via APIs. So in addition to that internal development that we're doing with these various APIs, they're also used with trusted partners to enable experiences like Pinterest. That's the screenshot. I'm sure it's probably hard to see, but on the left-hand side there. So you can see the price and availability of pinned items from Target. Also, the eBay marketplace, again, kind of product availability and inventory is enabled with APIs. And even Correlate, which enabled the Like to Buy platform, and that allows Instagram users to make purchases from their feeds. And that's that last image in the bottom right-hand corner there with a couple of different images from Instagram. So, right, a lot of different cool experiences that we can now enable pretty quickly because we have this data, exposed. Also, one of the really big new business capabilities that we worked on in 2013 was the ability to buy online and pick up in a Target store. And that, in fact, was the first use case that we had at Target to leverage Cassandra in our ecosystem. We had to ensure that data from those kind of slow back-end providing systems could be exposed at scale with fast response times. And so I'll talk on that a little bit more in a few minutes, but wanted to share a screenshot of what that would look like if, say, you wanted to buy a car seat and you were kind of doing some research online, you found the one that you wanted. What you see on the screen there is on the .com site, the different stores and whether or not that car seat would be available at a store. And in the example here, you could see I'd be able to go and pick that up at my Target store, which is the Minneapolis Nicollet Mall. And I would just click on that bucket or on that button rather, pick up in store, and then go and grab the baby seat. So it's a pretty cool, I'd say, again, like coming from a mom with two kids, if I can do a lot of my shopping online and then just go grab it in the store, that certainly makes my life a lot easier. So I love that the APIs that my team has worked on has helped enable that. Here's just a few more examples of some capabilities that have been enabled. These are from just screenshots from our mobile apps. And so anything from adding items to a cart and having it shipped to your house, adding items to a gift registry when you log on to, if you have a Target.com guest profile and you're logging into these apps, again, that's calling and using our APIs. Which I'm sure probably not a surprise, or my guess is not a surprise to most folks on the phone. Like, of course, you want to have an API strategy and program. And it's been really exciting. I've had a lot of fun leading this effort for one of the world's largest retailers, and I've learned so much in the past 3 years because it's been a pretty big journey with a lot of different roadblocks and barriers to work through in order to make this happen. And so remember, we're a large enterprise IT shop, and so that meant while we were building and exposing these APIs, but didn't mean that. But while we were building and exposing these APIs, we actually were also blazing the path for new technologies and how we do technology work within IT at Target. So it became pretty clear to us early on that we wouldn't be successful using kind of the traditional technology and implementation patterns that we had in place. So again, I'll talk specifically from a database perspective in a minute, but we're also talking about agile, not waterfall, delivering in smaller, more frequent releases, right? I mentioned my dislike for big quarterly releases, automating all of the things, continuous integration, continuous delivery, and of course, DevOps. So anybody that knows me knows that I have a ton of passion around DevOps. But before I talk about how we approach our development work, I'll talk about some of the technology choices that we've made to create a resilient and scalable platform. So we had a number of challenges that we needed to tackle in order to enable that platform. We had to handle huge volumes and meet availability and response times to enable the experiences I highlighted. So some of these challenges included, I've mentioned this, that many of our back-end providing systems of record at Target, they're on legacy technologies and they cannot scale or handle internet-facing traffic volumes. Also, many of those systems are typically pretty slow and also are cost prohibitive to call directly. Another challenge was we needed to take data from multiple systems and get that in one place. In fact, kind of interestingly, we had some data that we needed to get at that wasn't even in databases. So we had some fairly sizable challenges to overcome. So we started, of course, exploring the options within our traditional kind of database tools and approaches that were available to us within our IT environment. Now, of course, there were the traditional RDBMSs, but you know, the overall costs of those existing tools in our environment were extremely high, right? When you think about the licensing and the people and processes and support that surround those, you know, a lot of those processes that were in place to work with those technologies didn't fit the speed at which we were doing our work and iterating through our development process with the business. We also really thought it was important to have full stack ownership for our platform to enable us to move at the speed required to keep up with business demands. Also in this space, you know, options from a vendor and technology perspective are pretty limited, you know, in that traditional relationship database space. We knew we needed the flexibility to solve our various challenges, and there just weren't, you know, options weren't jumping out at us as we looked to see what was available to us within our organization. And kind of other barriers that we saw, you know, as we looked at kind of various options, that, you know, our existing our relational database space, they're not multi-tenant, and our platform continued to grow across multiple data centers, right? We have data in providing systems that are also spread across multiple data centers, and we're serving guests that are across the country, right? Also important to us was positioning our platform to move to the cloud that was kind of eminently on the horizon for us as well. So, you know, we wanted to ensure that the technology we chose would be able to make that happen for us. So, you know, just a lot of important considerations as we worked to find a solution that was going to help meet the challenges that we were looking at. Let's see. I mentioned full stack ownership. And as I said, it's important to us to have this because the ability to make changes, control performance, and have end-to-end visibility across our platform and APIs makes it increasingly easier and more efficient for us to kind of support and operate our entire platform and really understand our entire ecosystem. Availability was also a super important consideration. Do we all know the CAP theorem, right? Consistency, availability, partition tolerance. We can't tolerate downtime on our platform because that impacts the ability to enable those guest experiences that I was showing a few slides back. And I guess I don't want to give away the punchline. Maybe I already have, but with Cassandra, right? Like that's the whole point of Cassandra, right? There's no downtime anymore, and that was really, really appealing to us. Last constraint that I'm going to highlight for the traditional relational databases is that they don't lend themselves to automation. And we really wanted to be able to make changes. We really want to be able to automate how we make changes right? Manually making changes and kind of doing manual operational work is really, really prone to human error and doesn't allow us to create repeatable, testable build processes, right? So we wanted to use something like a chef or a puppet to manage the platform for us. All right, so of course, no surprise, right? We chose Cassandra as our data platform. This was the first implementation of a distributed NoSQL data store at Target, and it took a lot, it took quite a bit of selling to convince folks across our organization that it was the right technology for our use case. So remember, this was back in 2013. Cassandra was still a relatively new technology, at least in the enterprise IT space. And there just weren't a lot of kind of large IT shops using it at that time, and not a lot of people that had experience with it either. So what were some of the reasons we found Cassandra to be attractive? Well, so our NFRs, they're in milliseconds. We have TPS volumes in the tens of thousands. And I talked about how many of those back-end systems wouldn't be able to handle those requirements. And Cassandra has worked really well providing the scale and distribution that we need for our APIs. And it fit probably about 80% of our need, which is awesome. And all of our APIs, they have different tolerances in terms of, whether it's eventual consistency or performance. And Cassandra just was a great fit for us in this space. Another important consideration was, even though I just mentioned that Cassandra is a relatively new technology, it still has a number of years in development. And that was important. I would say, for me, that made it a lot easier for me to sell it kind of upward to my leadership team. And I'd also call out probably, as a result of this, we were able to move from, making the decision to getting Cassandra in production in about 3 months. And that's pretty impressive. I can't think of, my time in working in technology that we were able to work with and get something up and running. Now, granted, it was very simple compared to what we have up and running today in production, but we were able to move very quickly. Also appealing is that there's a really big ecosystem of developer tools, drivers, and a lot of different stuff available in multiple languages. And so that was important to us as well. Another important point is that technology should be Googleable, right? We want a strong technical community surrounding everything we use. And honestly, if you can't Google something, I'd say that's an immediate red flag in today's world. So additional points around why, again, why Cassandra was attractive. So open source really matters to us. We're shifting away from using a lot of black box tools and technologies, and we want to be part of the community and be able to contribute back. In fact, we've open sourced a chef cookbook for Cassandra that we use to automate deployments because it has been fairly easy for us to automate. I mentioned that as one of the barriers with existing tools that we're looking at. And if you're interested, you can check that out on our blog. It's target.github.io, and shout out to Danny Parker. He is the author of that cookbook. So another something else that was very appealing, and again was one of the key factors to helping me sell this to senior leadership, was leveraging the enterprise resources from DataStax. There's still some trepidation about using open source technologies, but when you have a vendor that can provide professional services and support, that eases a lot of those concerns and is a great way to step into using a technology like Cassandra. Cassandra also is pretty aligned with the work and investments that we've made within Target. So we're a Java shop. The hardware that we had worked pretty well. So we did need to work with our infrastructure team to shift to using local storage, and I've heard that a lot as I've talked with especially other large enterprise IT shops, that that's often a pretty big shift to make with the infrastructure teams, but I'd say it's very, very important. And then lastly, just calling out the simple pricing model. Again, that was really appealing to me and making my job a lot easier. I didn't have to spend, as I said, typical hours in negotiations trying to get the best deal for me. Because I don't know about you, but I do not like being in or working in a used car sales lot, and so it makes me really happy when I don't have to do that. All right, so I'm going to shift gears a bit to some other considerations and challenges that we worked through. Integrations are always tough, and we face similar challenges here as we did in that data store space. So I've mentioned time and time again the legacy technologies we have at Target. You know, a lot of those core back-end providing systems that I mentioned, a lot of those are on the mainframe. And so we had to do a lot of complex integrations to expose that data and move it into Cassandra. And I would guess many people on this call would face similar complexities. And this turned out to be one of the biggest challenges for our API program, which maybe is predictable, right? Like getting at that back-end data is always hard. But I know a lot of people are surprised by this when I talk with them about it. And yeah, it's definitely something that we have evolved in terms of how we've done it over the last 3 years. I'd call out that so CAML turned out to work really well for us in a lot of these integrations. There's definitely a learning curve. It took some practice, but over time it's become really powerful for us. And what we really like about it as well is that it's code, it's testable, it's not a GUI. And that's important because, you know, there's a tendency, again, in kind of large enterprise IT shops to rely on kind of GUI-based drag-and-drop integration tools. So what we were doing was a deviation from the standard patterns that had been defined. But, again, just another one of kind of many different ways that, you know, my team was pushing for change and driving a more modern approach to how we do development. Now, at the core of being successful with, you know, for this API program and what we've been able to accomplish over the last few years, you know, and using a lot of these more modern open source technologies, is really around building an empowered team with strong engineering and software development skills. Now, I could go on and on about the importance of this. Anybody that knows me on the call knows that I can. but I've summed up the approach by just saying DevOps. And so my team was the first to pioneer a number of those new technologies. You know, we were the first to embrace a DevOps culture, full stack ownership, and continuous integration and continuous delivery. And I would say it's essential to a lot of our success. And what's been great to see is that it's starting to be the standard for how we do software development work across our entire organization. I've shifted and I love this over the last year. I'm spending as much time evangelizing APIs and the work that my, you know, team is doing on a day-to-day basis to talking as much about DevOps and continuous integration and continuous delivery. Also worth calling out is that we have, so every quarter we hold an internal DevOps days, and at the end of February we actually have our first year celebration, so it'll be our kind of, yeah, 1 year anniversary of having quarterly DevOps days, which is very cool. And you can see the momentum building across our IT organization, where you're now hearing about DevOps in hallway conversations, whereas before it was kind of this mysterious taboo word that most people didn't want to use. Okay, so kind of back to our technology stack. I mentioned that we use a lot of automation. Everything is automated with Chef, including Cassandra, as I said. Managing everything with code is really important, especially as we continue to grow. We're able to easily and predictably scale because of this automation and the technologies that we use. So in retail, we see our volumes for our APIs and API platform increase more than tenfold during peak retail season, which starts on Thanksgiving and Black Friday. And you can imagine just kind of with that tenfold lift that we see, our business teams are also always looking for kind of new or interesting ways to drive more sales and experiences for our guests during that season. And so this automation's been critical to enable us to respond to these new business strategies, and it wouldn't be possible without that full stack automation that we've built into our platform. So of course being able to scale a platform is important, but having it also be available, response times what they need to be, that's equally as important. And so we have full stack logging and monitoring, and that has been, I can't even underscore how important that's been to us to kind of correlate across the different layers in our platform and then troubleshoot when issues occur, because we know that issues will occur. Right, and so the power of full stack visibility and ownership means that the team can, you know, we can quickly recover and resolve these issues before there's, typically before there's any actual system disruption for our consumers. So just a quick view of Ops Center that comes with DataStax. So I mentioned, you know, that DataStax has made it easy for us to step into using Cassandra. And DataStax Ops Center made it really, really easy for our level two support team to get a quick glance at overall system health, right? So if they're starting to see some errors, they could look into Ops Center to see if there was something funny going on. And then they were able to kind of pull in devs as they needed to help resolve those issues. And we now have, I think we have 20 nodes in production, and those are supported and operated by a very slim team. So this is my brag slide that I always like to include. So we have over 30 APIs in production. We have monthly volumes of more than 1.5 billion, and that continues to grow at a pretty significant clip month over month. In a typical week, we have more than 80 deployments and 250 commits. And our platforms and APIs are incredibly stable. So I call out on the slide that we have less than 10 incidents per month. It's actually closer to less than five. And you know, looking at those volumes, looking at the volume of change that we're constantly pushing into production, it's pretty incredible to have such a low incident volume. Now, there's also, I also really like to highlight the business case that we have as well. We've generated a really significant NPV with the with this investment in an API program with a really, really high IRR as well. You know, I mentioned how we do kind of logging and monitoring across the full stack, and that's part of the success story as well, is being able to capture some of these metrics, because when we first started 3 years ago, we didn't have all these metrics. I couldn't easily see the number of deploys happening or which developers were committing at what frequency, and now I can, and that's pretty powerful. So it's been a really fun, awesome three-year journey, and it's been really exciting to be a part of making this happen at Target. So the story I just told, that's kind of just the beginning for us and what we're doing within our IT organization and Target. 2015 has a number of important strategies. We have a lot of work ahead of us, continuing to create a more robust kind of enterprise data platform. We've really kind of scratched the surface with how we're using that right now to enable these APIs that I talked about, but just really continuing to drive and build that out in 2015 is a big priority. I mentioned that most of our API platforms hosted within Target data centers. Starting to shift to the cloud is a big focus for us in 2015 to really start taking advantage of that geographical dispersion and the proximity to our guests. And just underscoring again how shifting how we do development work just more broadly across our technology organization, really big focus, you know, for me, my team, and many across our IT group. So that's it. That's my story. I will turn it back over to Wayne, and you can start asking me questions.
Great. Thank you so much, Heather. All right, we do have a number of questions coming through. First one is, what were some of the non-traditional database alternatives to Cassandra that you considered, and what were a couple of things that made Cassandra the winner?
You know, the primary reasons that we chose Cassandra, so I hit on a few of them, right, and that's, you know, we wanted to have the ability to automate, having a distributed platform was also really important to us, and having the ability to start shifting into the cloud was really important for us as well.
Great. Another question. Earlier in your presentation, you had talked about silos. How many employees make up a silo at Target?
That's kind of a hard one to answer, I guess, because it would depend on your definition of silos and what we're talking about there. But yeah, so we have the typical what you'd seen in enterprise IT shop, where we have, you know, infrastructure teams, operation teams, and then app dev teams. And so, those I think are the traditional silos that you'll see within an enterprise IT shop, and we're very similar.
Okay. On your ROI slide, you had mentioned monthly volumes of 1.5 billion. What was that metric? Was it purchase transactions?
No, so those are volumes through the APIs. If that makes sense. So yes, transaction volumes.
Okay, so like interactions with a particular API.
Yep, calls to them. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Okay, how much data is in your entire cluster?
Oh, I should know that. I should have known that somebody was going to ask that. I do not know offhand. I don't know that answer offhand. I would happily, though, as a follow-up, get that.
Great. This kind of goes down the same lines. I don't know if you have these answers off the top of your head, but what are the what type of hardware are you using? Type of disks, type of nodes, et cetera.
I can send that in a follow up as well, because I don't want to give misinformation.
Sure, sure. All right. It's a question about the type of data stored in Cassandra. Are multimedia type of materials such as images and videos stored in Cassandra as well?
We currently are not doing that.
Okay. Are you using Chef Puppet for schema changes?
Chef, yes.
Okay. Oh, now you had mentioned someone on your team has a cookbook, right?
Yeah, and we have quite a bit of info. In fact, I can answer your question if I pull up the tech blog that will have the hardware specs there. So target.github.io. There's a number of posts about how we manage Cassandra, how we do a lot of our performance testing leading up to peak season. I'll see if I can multitask and pull that up and answer the hardware question here as we're talking. See. Yeah, 24-core processor, 400 gig of RAM, and 12 SSD hard drives for each of the nodes.
All right, great. Here's a question about your APIs. Are these APIs available for third-party developers?
That's an excellent question. They currently are available for our internal developers and then kind of trusted partners that Target has a relationship with. So we don't have them opened broadly for third-party developers yet.
Okay. Regarding your data points on fewer than 10 incidents per month, is there a closed loop incident tracking system to gain knowledge on these incidences?
Yes. We have an incident. We do have an incident management system. We distinguish between incidents and events. So if an incident comes in, that's typically something that's reported by a downstream consumer. And then we have many events that get created with the various alerting mechanisms that we have in place. So if I start to kind of breach response times that I have set up for a particular API. And then from a closed loop perspective, I hope I'm interpreting that question correctly. Whenever we have an incident, we do, we always do an RCA around that incident and work to, so we're not just doing kind of break, fix, restore it. We're also working to understand what the actual root cause was and closing that. Which is, if we weren't doing that, those incidents would probably creep up month over month. But instead, we kind of almost see the opposite trend where they've gone down for us. They've trended down for us over the last couple of years.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next question. How are you managing the federation of data from legacy systems into Cassandra and ensuring consistency while maintaining governance of the single source of the truth?
Boy, that's a good question, and that's a tough question. I would say that's a lot of, I mentioned in kind of what we've done to date has really just been kind of scratching the surface in terms of what data we've taken from those systems of record and pulled into Cassandra. 2015 is a really big year for us to start bringing more of that data into Cassandra. It also will be available in Hadoop we actually have a data architecture and management practice within Target. So we're working very closely with those data architects and that data management team to ensure we have the right type of governance in place. But that's definitely not easy to do, and it's especially not easy to do in a very complex environment, the complexity that we have within our environment and the just many, many different systems.
Okay. Let's see. This question might be slightly off topic, but it's around your APIs. Again, you had mentioned that the APIs are not currently available to external consumers. Do you have an API gateway in place to govern these APIs?
We do have an API gateway. We do have an API gateway in place. Yep. And that, provides API management for us, helps manage the kind of keys for developers, kind of all the typical API management things that you would expect from a gateway.
Okay. How distributed are your Cassandra nodes?
So right now they are they're just within our Target data center, so they're not incredibly distributed. But that starts to change for us in 2015 as we start to move from our internal data centers into the cloud.
So are you going 100% into the cloud?
We will start to do that in 2015. Now there might still be, so our APIs I mentioned are also, so they're used internally as well. So there might be use cases where it makes sense for us to keep some of those internal. But the bulk of the volumes that our APIs are serving are for guest experiences. So it actually will be fantastic to have, Cassandra more distributed, because that will just improve our response times and make guest experiences even better than they are.
Okay. Are you storing text data such as customer sentiments, like emails and blogs and tweets, things like that, in Cassandra?
No, we're not. We're using it. It's just data that we have within our systems of record for things like product information or inventory information, kind of price promo. That's all that, yeah. So, no.
Okay. Well, that's about it. There are a few other questions that kind of get deeper into the weeds from a technology perspective. So I think we'd probably be better off handling those offline. So we can take those offline, and for those of you who didn't have your questions answered, we'll be able to email you answers in the next day or so. So if there aren't any other final comments from you, Heather, I think we can wrap up.
No, thank you for the time today. Hopefully the talking through that story was helpful to folks on the phone. I'd love to hear feedback as well. So if anybody has thoughts or ideas on what would have been more interesting to hear about or hear less about, please feel free to pass that my way.
Fantastic. All right. Well, thank you, everyone, for joining. Thank you again, Heather, for presenting. Really appreciate it, and have a great rest of the day.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.